Warning. The images that follow are almost entirely hand-drawn with pencil, Sharpie, and crayons. It is stupid on purpose. Titus Andronicus is a violent play. There is a great deal of crayon blood in what follows. Titus Andronicus by William Shakespeare. Titus Andronicus, Shakespeare's first tragedy, was written and believed to be first performed in 1592. Titus remains Shakespeare's bloodiest and most violent work. I mean, it's bloody. Like these characters are frickin' drowning in blood at the end of this play. The play claims 14 lives, 9 of them on stage, 8 severed members, 1 rape, 1 live burial, 1 case of insanity, and 1 of cannibalism. As a result, Titus was believed to be the most popular of his plays in his time, probably because of all the blood. Today, however, it has been discredited as one of Shakespeare's lesser works. T.S. Eliot said that Titus is one of the stupidest and most uninspiring plays ever written. T.S. Eliot is stupid. Brief synopsis. Titus Andronicus came home from wars with the Goths, having lost 21 of his 25 sons, and despite her begging, sacrifices the oldest son of Tamora, queen of the Goths, to appease the gods. Herein lies the root of Titus's overlying theme of revenge, and how revenge begets revenge begets revenge. Aaron, Tamora's lover and villain of the play, is just an evil guy. He comes up with the revenge for Tamora against Titus. Dude, it's just freaking messed up. He persuades Demetrius and Chiron, Tamora's remaining sons, to kill Bassianus and satisfy their immense lust on Lavinia, Titus's only daughter and Bassianus's wife, by raping her. They do so and cut off Lavinia's hands and cut out her tongue so she can't tell anyone what happened to her. Aaron then frames Martius and Quintus for Bassianus' death, and they themselves are sentenced to death. Lucius, Titus's other son, is then banished for trying to free his brothers. Aaron then approaches Titus and tells him that if he cuts off a hand, his sons will be pardoned. He does so, and later Titus's hand, along with his sons' heads, are delivered to him. Did I mention Aaron was evil, or... At this point in the play, as a result of the immense grief he has experienced in such a short amount of time, Titus outwardly begins to lose his mind. He starts pleading to things for justice. He pleads to stones, earth, water, even nothing. He pleads to nothing. He even fires arrows with notes for all of the gods into heaven, pleading that they may send down justice. The guy was Looney Tunes. Lavinia then, using a stick, writes Stuprum Demetrius Chiron in the sand, communicating that Demetrius and Chiron were the ones who had raped her. Meanwhile, Lucius has been amassing an army of Goths to march on Rome. Oh snap. Tamora then approaches Titus dressed as Revenge, sent to carry out Titus's justice. She comes along with her sons dressed as Rape and Murder. He agrees to hold a dinner at his home for her, the Emperor, his sons, and a constituency from the Goths, on the condition that Rape and Murder remain with him. Why Tamora agrees to do this, I don't know. Maybe she needed some alone time, I don't know. They do, and knowing their true identity, Titus captures them, and like everyone about to murder someone, he tells the brothers his plan. Hark, villains, I will grind your bones to dust, and with your blood and it I'll make a paste, and in that paste a coffin I will rear, and make 2 pasties of your shameful heads, and bid that strumpet, your unhallowed dam, like to the earth, swallow her own increase. Titus pulls a Mrs. Lovett, and he kills the brothers, bakes them into pies, and serves them to Tamora at the dinner. He then kills Lavinia to spare her of her shame, announces that the pies are human pies, and kills Tamora. Saturninus, the emperor and Tamora's husband, then kills Titus, who is swiftly killed by Lucian. Aaron, the founder of Tamora's revenge, is captured and buried waist-deep in sand to be starved, and despite his punishment is unrepentant of his villainy. Ah, why should wrath be mute and fury dumb? I am no baby, I, that with these base prayers I should repent the evils I have done. 10,000 worse than ever yet I did would I perform if I might have my will. If one good deed in all my life I did, I do repent it from my very soul. To say that Titus is stupid and uninspiring is to deface the collected body of Shakespeare's tragic characters, God forbid. In it, we see elements of many of his great tragic characters. In Titus, we see the age and confusion of King Lear, the insanity, or even staged insanity, the revenge-seeking and indecisiveness of Hamlet, and even a bit of Othello's misguidedness. In the villain Aaron, a Moor who frequently refers to himself and is referred to as slave, a man who has been castrated his entire life because of his skin color and seeks to burden his enemies with the same pain and anguish that is intrinsic to his own life as a result of his skin's hue, we see a direct connection to many other Shakespearean villains, particularly Shakespeare's most famous villain, Richard III, who suffered from a debilitating physical condition which forced him to compensate with evil. There is a link between when Aaron says, "Aaron will have his soul black like his face," and Richard III saying, "Since I cannot prove a lover, I am determined to prove a villain." They are both compensating for a debilitating condition that they cannot help, with evil. There is also comparison to be made between Aaron and the Merchant of Venice's Shylock, who, like Aaron, is discriminated against because he is different. In this case, Shylock is Jewish. There are also undoubted connections between Aaron and Othello as well. Both Aaron and Othello must face outlandish racism from characters around them and are forced to submit to deeds outside their nature. In The Moor of Venice, Othello demonstrates evil at the end of the play when he kills Desdemona, his wife, and Aaron shows goodness toward the end of Titus Andronicus when trying to remove his son from under the knife. These are contradictory elements and conflicted characters. They are unpredictable and thusly dangerous to both of them. And for comparison's sake, stepping outside the scope of Shakespeare's racist tendencies, one could easily compare Aaron the Moor to Iago, who is cunning like Aaron in his devious schemes. While these comparisons may be deemed loose and irrelevant by some, they are relevant in arguing Titus' success as a play nonetheless. The elements that make Shakespeare's tragic heroes and villains great are all present in Titus Andronicus. While the play may seem a little convoluted at times, as all these elements are forced into five acts as opposed to five plays, they are present. Titus's may be seen as a precursor to Shakespeare's later and greater works. The out-of-control spiral of revenge in this play is deeper than the play's body count as well. It was the Elizabethan belief that only God could carry out vengeance, and therefore any tragic hero who takes vengeance into his own hands had to thusly become the villain himself. Let's not forget, all of the revenge in this play is justified. Tamora's son is dismembered and burned, and just about everyone Titus knows dies. The story is tragic because everyone has motive to get their revenge, but it's the revenge itself that kills them. And Aaron's just friggin' evil. It's just evil. The moral of this story is that Titus Andronicus, though incredibly messed up with vengeance and death, is a good play. Confusing, yes, but innovative and a good precedent for the plays that were to come.
That's it, sucker!